Okay, welcome everyone to Deafblind Information Australia's webinar today. This webinar is hosted on the lands of the Whadjuk people of the Noongar Nation. Our presenters today, one of them joins me from the same land and the other presents from the lands of the Turrbal and Yagara people. I acknowledge them and the traditional custodians of the lands on which our panel and our audience are living, working and learning. Today's webinar on orientation and mobility is presented in two parts, firstly by Narelle Bredhauer, and then following her, Claire Sullivan will join us. Each of them is going to do a little introduction to themselves. So without further ado, I invite Narelle to the screen to start the webinar.
Thanks so much, Melanie. I've been enjoying so much participating viewing the webinars that are already on Deafblind Information Australia's website. It's been great for my own learning, and I'm very excited to be here today to be able to share some of my learning in orientation and mobility. First of all, I've got some important thank yous to make. So first of all, to the Department of Education Queensland and Statewide Vision Impairment Services, who have allowed me to participate in this activity. Most importantly, to the families who have given permission to share some beautiful images and videos of their children to enrich everybody's learning. To the teachers and staff from Narbathon Special School, especially the Circle Room and Diamond Room, those teams. To Tricia Borg for encouraging me to participate in this activity, and to my very special thank you to my colleague and friend Nikki Webb. We share our work and our learning in orientation and mobility, and this learning and this presentation wouldn't be possible without our collaboration. So, to tell you a little bit about myself, I'm a teacher with training in vision impairment as well as orientation and mobility. I have been working for the Department of Education in Queensland for, goodness, over 35 years, and I have had so much rich learning from working with a variety of students who are blind, vision impaired, and deafblind. It's just been a wonderful career. So let's dig in. Am I on the right slide? Sorry, technology. So we need to be down here. Thank you. Sorry about that delay. So my hopes for you today are that you build an understanding of why orientation and mobility is important for people with deafblindness, that you recognise that learning in orientation and mobility begins early in life, that the individual needs to do the learning for themselves in orientation and mobility, and that the conditions that allow this to occur are really important and sometimes critical. The hopes for all my students that I work with are that they develop a sense of agency, enabling choice, control, freedom of movement, self-determination, health and well-being, safety and access. On this first slide, there's a beautiful image of a young learner. He's about 8 years old. The rain has fallen, creating deep puddles on the school oval, and he is sitting down low, putting his hands on the grass and his face while he's gathering the sensory information and having just a lovely time. So our sensory systems is the way we connect to our environment. Our senses help build our understanding of what is happening in any given moment. For each one of us, our senses connect us to the world around us. They are the way in which we obtain information, gain understanding, and interact with objects, people, and the environments around us. Sensory information directs our attention and influences our actions. Experiences that connect us to our environment supports development in other areas, such as language, cognitive, fine and gross motor skills, and social interactions. Our senses are our gateway to the world. So what is orientation and mobility? Put in simple terms, orientation is knowing where you are in your environment, and mobility is the ability to move in one's environment. If we break this down a little bit further, we can look at the developmental sequence of O&M skills. Firstly, the orientation process. The child learns to understand the spatial dimensions of the body. The child learns about the area surrounding their own body. And then the child learns about her world in larger and larger dimensions, including the environment and the content of each setting. So it's important that we start with our bodies. We then move into the near space where we can reach, and then and we perhaps interact then with our hands and our feet and different parts of our body. And then this extends and perhaps to be a traveler of the world. When we look at the sequence mobility, movement begins with reflexes, where the child has no control. The child then learns to move with intent towards a specific object or stimulus. Then the motor skills are refined, becoming more skillful and of higher quality. And lastly, with increased movement and capability, the child moves out into space with simple goal intention. The complexity of this goal-directed intention can keep increasing throughout the child's life. We have to pay really close attention to the "and" in orientation and mobility, as it's the continued interaction between both these processes that leads to the achievement of spatial skills. If we think back to the early slide when we talked about the sensory experience, every time we move, we have a whole different set of sensory information that we have to gather and interpret. And this is a reciprocal process that keeps on occurring, even if that movement for the child is very small while they're doing this early learning. So this is something to think about, and that's why I've got the "mmm". So this is your "mmm" acronym. When we're thinking about learning and development for the young child, we're thinking about movement, meaning, and motivation. these areas are all equally important and overlapping. They're very entwined, just like development is very enmeshed. The absence of any of these areas will really have an impact on the development of the child when they're learning their orientation and mobility skills. So as an example, if a child is not moving, they won't be interacting with their environment as much. They may be paying attention to something different and the development will stop. If the child is having an experience of high anxiety, their motivation to move will be really interrupted, and their action could be very different. They may need to get down low to the ground to feel safe and secure. If the child hasn't achieved certain cognitive skills, they may not have meaning attached to the environment that they're working in, or they may not have the skills, the cognitive skills, to achieve the desired outcomes. An example would be the achievement of object permanence, which is which looks really different and really requires different conditions for our students who are blind. Okay. I've got an image here of the same young learner, a little boy around 8. He's very focused, gathering information with his hands on a drain, a metal drain. In one hand, he's holding a little rock, and he's showing real concentration and has a closer viewing distance as he's thinking about what he's going to do next in this space. So, why O&M? Because O&M builds confidence in our students. It lowers their anxiety. It builds important concepts. It motivates movement, encourages exploration, supports sensory development, increases meaningful communication, and develops functional skills. So as an O&M, when I'm evaluating O&M needs, I'm really considering the impact of the student's functional vision, sensory skills, conceptual understanding, formal O&M techniques, which includes things like sighted guide and use of cane skills, and the functional application of the O&M strategies, which really pulls all these areas together. This really highlights the need to know each individual learner. I love the work that Melanie has done in this space with her life spaces model. It's really, really a great start for teams. It's also really important to acknowledge the importance of listening to our families when we're learning about learners, and also the transdisciplinary team. The teams for some of these learners are so big, and we really need to respect and value and listen to each other to find the right work for our students. So on this slide, I've got some lovely images of a little girl. She's 4. She has a diagnosis of septo-optic nerve hyperplasia, a vision diagnosis. She has a diagnosis of nerve neuropathy for hearing. I've probably said that wrong. it's gone from my mind. But she has profound bilateral hearing loss, and she is blind. In her O&M program, and there's so many layers to her program, but this part of her program, we're actually it's just an example of doing of some of the things we've already talked about. We're focusing on developing a concept of a door, which is really important for our young learners. It's also an area that can be a bit of a sticking point for some students. It's a lifelong concept. There's so many different things we can learn about doors. They lead into a different set of sensory information that's really related to context of what's happening in that room. They can open in different ways. They can be different sizes. In these images, you can see she's doing some really detailed exploration. At one point, in the first image, she stretched her whole body out. If you look really closely, her little toes are actually finding the table behind. She's using her whole body as a measuring tool. She's checking the step down with her face, with her fingers. In the next image, she's facing inward into the room, and she's really paying close attention to the ridges that are on that sliding door frame. And then on this lovely last image, she's hooking her body around, paying attention with her hand to what's side, popping her little foot out, gathering some beautiful tactual information with her toes. And she's got her hand on her head, and I'm wondering whether she's thinking about this experience, and she certainly looks pretty happy, which tells me that this is probably the right work for her at this point in time. I've got some video footage to share with you so you can see some of these explorations in action. So I'm going to ask my admin member here just to pop the first one up. This is very focused exploration. She's using her face, she's using her mouth. She's really motivated. This is important work to her, I'm thinking. And we'll pop the next one up. We'll show you a little series, and then we can have a little chat about it. Put the line on there. So here she is. She's moved away from that door frame. She's got her back against the nearby glass wall. Oh, she's found something with her toes. There's a mat. She's turning. She's rechecking that glass. The space is really small. The tactual changes are really lovely and obvious. She's tapping that. She might be getting a little bit of sound. She's definitely checking the texture. Check with those toes as well. That's really important. She's leaning back, and she's actually using her body as a bit of a measure. She's propped her little elbows on the mat, stretched her toes, and now she's come back in with her hand. Oh, yes, she's found there's an edge there as well. And she might even be thinking, oh, that step's consistent and runs along. And we've got one more in this little series. So she's standing in that door frame now with her teacher. This is a great line.
I've got one of your crackers on my hand. Here it is. It's on my hand.
You know, she's checking. I'm guessing she's checking the hardness of the door, the surface. She's looks very happy. She seems like she knows this space well and this door well.
Try the bag.
Her teacher is so skilled. She's encouraging her, following her lead, and listen, and you know, and paying such close attention and being on offer and nearby to give us such such a good feeling of safety, I'm thinking.
Are you not finished at the door?
So she's clearly saying, I need a bit more time here. This is important work for me. You know, I'm practicing my balance. I'm practicing my standing. I might be thinking about where I am. I'm remembering how this door feels from this position.
See your eyes going up.
Yeah, she finding that little bit of sun there.
She was, you know, I haven't seen much of her functional vision, but we saw a little bit there, just where she found that really bright sun in sun for a second.
Yes, yes, we can go walking now. Yes, yep, let's go.
And she's ready to move on. So this really, I think, is a lovely demonstration of some of that process that we spoke about before. And it shows the need for such detailed exploration and time, often beginning down low to build confidence and understanding of the textural changes underfoot. The space is really nice and close, so this learner has opportunity for incidental learning, and she's showing us that she's ready to branch out. You know, she's branching out from her body, and she does is at the moment is doing many different things on days that she explores in this space. One of her teacher aides said to me, oh, the other day she actually turned her whole body around. That table that she found with her toe, she put her head right under and had a good I'm guessing a good, really good think about that. So we see the spatial relations, the learning all coming together that is impacting her concepts and her self-determination and her choice in movement. This learning will be transitioned to other places. It's very exciting. Comparison is really important. So we're actually exploring two doors within her classroom. We're also exploring another really important door in her routine, heading to the bathroom. And in these slides, I'm really wanting to illustrate the importance to observe and really refine and think really hard about the decisions that you're making. I find this really hard work. I really try and collaborate with the teacher who knows the student really, really well. And so in the first image, you can see the student standing in the doorway. Her little toes have found the ridge and, you know, her feet are really important and I have to respect that learning of those toes. I'm thinking it's such a lovely comparison because it's actually got some similarities as well. So the ridge is very different on this door to the other one, but the width and the material that the door is made out of is actually the same and probably, you know, has the same hardness, the same sound, the same texture and the same temperature. So that's really nice. And then you might be able to see, so I've taken a photograph from further away to show the whole door, but then I've pulled in to be more detailed on the third image. And the adjustments that we've made are really quite small. The mat with the toys, there's a little mat with the toys, and we've pulled that right up to be adjacent to the door. And then just by luck, the teacher installed a baby gate for some other learners. And so there's some little circles, one high and one low, that are a little tactual circle that have been added to this doorway. And she's decided that they're good, important features. And if I look at this next slide, you can see by pulling that in, it means that perhaps, you know, it means she knows that there's something nearby, that it's not just tiles in that space. There's actually something else there. And she might be able to explore that if she chooses down the track. It's also enabled her to do different work when she's standing at the door. So at that first door, you know, you could see her practicing her balance with one and with two hands in a different way. But here she's got two materials, so she can actually do some, perhaps some knee bending. This perhaps will allow her to go to transition her body different. And so again, it's that importance of incorporating all opportunities of development in the learning. Ooh. I know I'm running out of time. I'm going to just try and quickly move through these last couple of slides. Melanie, are you happy for me to keep going? I'm very mindful that I'm a little bit over.
No, yes, please. Keep going, Narelle.
Okay. So in this image, this is part of another orientation and mobility program that my colleague ran. This is this is again another learner, the same little boy before, who has congenital deafblindness as well. He from a vision perspective, he's got CVI, very high myopia, glaucoma in his left eye. He has, I think, from memory, moderate hearing loss, and a diagnosis of PARP, P-A-R-P. And he's peering through a fence, looking, and the fence is over a creek. He's got, again, a really rich sensory environment. The space is small if he's choosing to cross from one side of the fence to the other. If he's got a long distance, for the long distance of the walk, we've also got the wagon there so that he can, if he's fatigued. So when we're choosing the learning space, it's actually really very, very important for developing our orientation mobility skills. We're thinking about the size, the sensory qualities, the structure and features, and the definition of the space, accessible edges, and the student interest and motivation. When supporting access to learning environments, we also need to think about the role of the adult and how the adult can support the success of the program. We're considering proximity, positioning and repositioning, considering receiving sensory information via another object. This is particularly important for students in wheelchairs, students in walkers, students in strollers. We're responding, we're offering opportunities, we're acknowledging the learner and helping them feel seen. We're supporting the learner to attend, and we're allowing the learner opportunity to initiate and explore. And most importantly, we are observing really hard, because these learners cannot articulate and tell us what's going on for them. And so we are making our best guess and doing our best to support their development to continue. So in summary, when I'm thinking about my learners with complex needs, I'm considering their access to the environment, the time and the opportunity that they have to do this important learning, that they have choice and control. Their mobility is typically more passive, so I'm expecting that it might look a little bit different, and I'm really digging down deep on the little details, and I know that careful observation and rapport are critical. So thank you, everybody. It's my pleasure to now introduce Claire O'Sullivan. It's been lovely to meet her during this presentation, and I know she's going to be able to shed some new information from her very different experiences to mine, with a really different O&M lens. So welcome, Claire.
Great, thanks everybody. So from the top, I just wanted to do an acknowledgement of country, but more specifically thinking about it from an orientation and mobility context. So orientation is knowing where you are, and mobility is knowing where you are going. So I want to acknowledge that where I am, I'm on Whadjuk Noongar land, and where we're going, I want to move through in a spirit of healing and reconciliation, especially given that it's Reconciliation Week this week. I want to honour the traditional wayfinding and understanding of nature through the patterns of stars and wayfinding through the songlines. I also want to acknowledge the experiences of deaf, hard of hearing, blind, low vision, and deafblind people in the meeting today, and acknowledge my place as a sighted and hearing person. I acknowledge the spectrum of different people with dual sensory loss, and that what one, something works for one person may not work for another. I want to acknowledge the practitioners, many of whom I know in this room and have worked with, and all the knowledge that I have got from them and that we share together. So I finished my diploma way back of Auslan way back in 2003, during that time at Leaderville TAFE with the late, great Sharon Barry Grassick, whose infectious passion for deafblindness subsequently made me have a career that's lasted the last almost 20 years. From there, I worked as a communication guide. I worked at Census, Deafblind UK, and at Able Australia. Once when I was working at Able, I was working with somebody who asked to be guided to a train station. And then when we arrived at the train station, she said, "I've got this from here." And I remember thinking, how? Then I discovered about orientation and mobility, and that was the how. I found out that there was a profession and you could work with people on how to get them to places safely, confidently, and independently. This could be as varied as the individual. It could be looking at finding the kettle in the house that you're in, all the way to complex public transport programs. Orientation and mobility is considered under the Allied Health banner, and with the NDIS, it's billed as capacity building. So currently, to study orientation and mobility in Australia, there's a postgraduate two-year course offered through the University of New South Wales. Most people have a teaching or an allied health background to get into the course. So for me, coming from a background of working with deafblind people, I remember walking into vision things thinking, this doesn't seem very complex. I have found that in the years since graduating that there are still continual things to learn. And if you decide to come and be an O&M, then you'll learn that there's many things to continue to learn. The registered body of the Orientation and Mobility Association of Australia is called the OMAA. And recently you may have heard people, there's talk of standardizing the qualifications. So you might have heard people going through COM certification, which is a US exam. And it's big and scary exam. So you may have heard people going through that process, just so you know a little bit about the profession. Because my reflection of being a comm guide before was that I did not know very much about this as a profession. So since qualifying as an O&M, I've worked at Guide Dogs Victoria in Melbourne and now at Visibility in Perth. So I'll just go to the next slide. And the next one, thank you, Renee. So vision, there's a picture of a brunette woman looking off into the distance. When we think of deafblind client vision, what do we know about their functional vision? So if you're a comm guide or a therapist, I ask you to ask yourself about how much you know about the people that you work with and their functional vision. Can they see light? Could this be helpful in orientating them more safely? Are they going to have a trickier time in low light? Are they going to struggle with depth perception? Do you know how to read an eye report? I ask this as somebody within, 15, 16 years of deafblindness, and I had never read an eye report or really understood very much about vision. When I reflect on my time as a comm guide, I think that at times I could have understood if I could understand eye reports better. I could have assisted by moving people to different lighting to communicate better. I could have been able to potentially provide contrast to be able to see something more clearly. Understood people's daily vision fluctuations, opened or shut a blind in the home, potentially for orientation or for communication, understood the prognosis for people who have vision loss, progressive vision loss. So I was able to help in future-proofing them, assisting in glare management and understanding things like from going light to dark and dark to light, specifically if you're going in and out of shopping centres and things like that. If you don't understand an eye report, yours or someone else's, that is understandable. Ophthalmologists write them in ways, clinical ways that are often full of jargon. I know that you have done recently potentially a thing on orthoptists who help look at functional vision. But also with O&Ms, often they're the only allied health people that have an ongoing vision-specific knowledge working with the client. So use them, ask for them to help you understand somebody's vision if you don't understand an eye report. Okay, the next slide, please. Thank you. So guiding and moving together. So I guess when Narelle was talking, she's looking at more from that early intervention, and I'm thinking about people that I work with who are adults. So traditional guiding, you're looking at sort of like the Lego man grip with the cupped hand that will go on the guide's arm. When we think about guiding for deafblind people, there's often a lot more physical contact involved. So there, I've definitely guided people where you might have hands intertwined or forearms touching. The more information and more preview that's possible. Things that I would think to move away from would be hand-holding or anything where the person who is being guided is not having full control, but also not having full control, but is not also not getting as maximum preview as possible about what's happening when you're going through walking over different areas. Folks who are congenitally deafblind can often be moved from A to D without having access to B and C. So an example of that is if you're in a day center and you are moving from, say, the kitchen to the outside area to go for a walk, sometimes people can be moved without being explained where they're going or why they're going to that. Ways of giving this could be developing some consistent haptic communication, giving a haptic clue. So somebody could, for example, sign walk and grass if that was the activity. They could sign that on their body. They could give them a picture cue, or they could give them a piece of astroturf to indicate that that's where they're going, giving people preview to their where they're going and moving through their environment rather than just moving. And as Narelle mentioned before, it also same for wheelchairs. I've been in different places where people's wheelchairs have been moved without people understanding why or where they're being moved to. So yeah, developing some consistent things so that people know where they are in their environment and where they're going in their environment. Being lost is great. Sometimes sighted people can look at people when they're lost and feel like that's something that they need to correct. For example, if someone has gone into a room and can't find the exit, people will want to move them away to find to quote unquote fix it for them and not allow that time to explore where they are in their space. I think it's important to monitor for any signs of discomfort or anxiety, but what can be apparent to a sighted person of someone being lost may be causing no anxiety and be also in the spirit of exploration. Getting lost is a part of exploring and understanding your environment. I also want to acknowledge that there's times that people need to move and get to a place in a hurry, but just rethinking all the different times that you can give people the opportunity to explore. If you're out in an open space, thinking about anchoring to a wall or a chair, can you guide the person to something in the environment rather than beginning the process of always being guided to another human person? And don't assume any knowledge. I was once working with a young man, congenitally deafblind man, in London. We were at a fair, and I said he communicated by fingerspelling. So I asked him if he wanted to go on a jumping castle, thinking that this would be exciting because he could fall and it would be fun to fall. It wasn't until he agreed that he wanted to go on a jumping castle. When we got inside the jumping castle, I realized that he had never been on a jumping castle. So we were in a situation where he was leaning on me and I was trying to hold him up whilst communicating that he couldn't lean on me. So I guess realizing that somebody, even if they have some formalized language, may be missing out on some concepts of different environmental things. Okay. Object, making sense of the world when you're deafblind. Thank you, Renee. Thanks for your slide. Concept development is a big one, as Narelle was talking about, that early concepts. But sometimes when you're working with adults, those concepts that Narelle was working on may not have been developed. Object permanence is a really big thing. So you might have somebody, I remember a woman who was thought to have, or a young woman who was thought to have some behavioural, some challenging behaviours, because she was continually throwing her cup after finishing drinking her cup of tea, rather than with some thinking around it within a team. It was understood that instead of the cup being placed on the ground and her hands being taken to it, it was being held to her in the ground. It was being given to her from the air. So when she was finished drinking her cup of tea, she was putting her cup of tea back into the air from which it came. Similarly, people leaving a room, how does the deafblind person know if you are going to the bathroom or if you are leaving from your session? So I remember a young person that I was working with, we would do double arm to say I'll be back, and then to say goodbye, I would put my hand underneath his hand and wiggle my fingers, and he would do a slap slap, and that was the end of our session. So that was the haptic things that with their family that we used. Another thing of using object permanence could be somebody might store different pieces of things in their mouth so that they're able to find them. I can think of somebody that I was working with who was really into mechanics, and again, storing different screws inside his mouth so he could find them to retrieve them and continue to work on what he was working on. It's really important when working with somebody to find what the person is interested in and using that as a springboard for connection, but also as part of the motivation to move. Lots of people have different interests in different objects or hobbies that they have, and using them as a springboard for connection. Other concepts that need to be developed or may not be developed once you meet someone and they're adult is up, down, over, under, those sorts of things. And as we saw in Narelle's beautiful videos, those early intervention with the O&M, so that the movement is with, but not, sorry, take two. The movement is with another human being, not by a human being. Putting mobility aids in people's hands early. Mobility aids could look like a long cane. It could look like an adaptive mobility device. So that's something that has more of a handle. And then you can also think outside of the square of what those things could look like too. It could be a hula hoop, a piece of rope, anything in the environment. It could be a stick to give those previews of different things that people can use to get a preview of their environment. Okay, next one, please, Renee. Thank you. Early intervention. I've done that. Thank you. Smells are a really good way to understand your environment. I was working with a young person, and the haptic cue that we had to smell something was to do a double tap on his nose. He would do a really big inhalation to draw his attention to his environment. Different smells that you could use for orientation could be a coffee shop, fast food, KFC, the bins, which is not such a delightful one. That's a really good way to share exploring the information, is using smell. You could have a smell that you use at the beginning of your session and a smell that you use at the end. For example, you could arrive on your session, spray some rosemary, and when you leave, you spray some lavender. Knowing if that client has good sense of smell is important. There are many different medications that people can be on, or hormonal changes or chemical changes. So discovering that with the people that you work with, to know if that person has smells that they like and if that their smell is all good and functioning. But also knowing that there's some smells that can be really, really bad and really distressing for people who are deafblind, or for anyone. But, you know, I have known clients to have a very strong reaction to cigarette smoke, or a strong reaction to something. So considering where smell might fall for orientation, but also for that could be an unpleasant smell. Consider drawing clients' attention to feelings in their legs. For example, when they're going up hills or down hills, that could be used as an orientation strategy for them. Consider drawing clients' attention to changes in surfaces underfoot. We saw that in the different surface changes in Narelle's videos, but continuing that with adults that you might work with. So Examples of surface changes could be going from parquetry to concrete or concrete to grass, and drawing people's attention to that. The next one, haptics. These can be formalized signs or signals that you as a team work on. So using consistent different haptics could be, you know, like I talked about with that young man, whenever we always use I'll be back, and we always use the same thing for bye, and everybody in his team used that. It's a balance between using the same haptics and trialing different things to see what works. The most important one for O&M is stop. To negotiate that very quickly, so that could be on the back, a stop to pull up nice and sharp. Different haptics that I have used in working with people would be to left on the back to turn towards the left, or right towards the right, faster, using my hand to say that we need to speed up or slow down. There are different things that you could use in your environment when you're working with people. But stop being the most important. Haptics can also be in technology that you might use. You might have a phone with a vibrating alarm, or a that will give to know that time is up, or a vibrating clock. Okay, next one. Thank you. So safe mobility and dignity of risk. This is a huge balancing act to know what is okay to take risks with. And I think it's about working in a team to know what is a safe risk. I think sometimes people can be walking around a space and they're about to run into a bin that is always there. Is that a part of helping someone to know where they are by knowing that that bin is there, or are they going to hurt themselves? Things where someone's going to hit their head or fall down, but allowing people to run into different parts of the furniture once you've evaluated if it's a safe thing to do. I think it's important to know whether the people we are working with, can they protect themselves? Are they able to do protect themselves above their head, or is there something that they're going to run into? And protecting themselves could also be using a long cane. If they're using that effectively, you don't necessarily need to tell them that there's a curb. But knowing your client and knowing if they can protect themselves. I do think that people working can create a fear when there isn't one, if the risk has been deemed to be safe. Okay. Working together. There are many different people working in deafblindness, and often it's about understanding the different roles that people play so that we can work together. I know that as a comm guide, I didn't understand what an O&M did. I now work with people as an O&M who don't understand what I do. And I think it's really important that we use a collaborative approach to get better outcomes for the client. Often, you know, interpreters might not understand what an O&M, O&M might not understand what an interpreter does, for example. And then that can lead to communication breakdown. Workers, particularly comm guides and support workers, can massively increase or decrease somebody's independence. So again, it's about knowing what is possible to achieve together. And be mindful of putting what you think is not possible or safe onto a client. I've been working with some people that may say, support workers that might say, oh no, that person couldn't possibly do that, when in fact it's worth trying and it could be possible. And it could give that person more freedom in their environment. So working together about what is possible, trying things to see what works, and holding the client in mind of what is best outcomes for that client, but not creating a culture of fear about someone's safety if there is, calculated and assessed risks. Thank you, Renee. So, refer people to O&Ms. I think that often people can be underrepresented in terms of referrals to O&Ms, and it's great to work together as a team for all the skills that we have.